If you have your Bibles, would you please turn with me to the book of Philippians? The book of Philippians, chapter 2. Our text this morning is going to be verses 17 through 24, but I want to go back for our scripture reading to verse 12 and pick it up there. Verse 12, because there's a whole theme that is flowing through these verses, and I break it up a little bit differently than what some other people break it up. But that's all right. We'll discuss that another time. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 says this, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out or live out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do of His good pleasure. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may be blameless and harmless children of God, without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ that I have neither run in vain nor labored in vain. Yes, and if I am poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith, I am glad and I rejoice with you all. For the same reason, you also be glad and rejoice with me. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly, that I may be encouraged when I know of your state. For I have no one like-minded who will sincerely care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things that are of Jesus Christ. But you know his proven character, that as a son with his father he has served with me in the gospel. Therefore, I hope to send him at once, as soon as I see how it goes with me. But I trust in the Lord that I myself also shall come shortly." Will you bow with me, please, and let's pray together. Father, now before we open your word, we want to come into your presence, and we want to just ask you for your direction, for your leadership, for your wisdom. We want to ask you for the Holy Spirit to teach us as you've promised He'll do. Father, open our hearts, open our souls, and quiet the distractions from the outside to receive what you have for us from this passage this morning. And we'll give you thanks in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen. Serving in humility is chapter 2. Now, the theme of the book of Philippians is the mind of the believer. The mind of the believer. And we find that in chapter 2 and verse 5. I believe this is the theme verse for all of the book of Philippians. He says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." And if you go back to chapter 1, now these are not inspired, okay? This is mine, and I actually stole it from somebody else years and years ago. But I call chapter 1 the gospel mind. If you look at chapter 1, Paul is talking about the gospel. He's talking about sharing Jesus Christ with people. And he's sharing an emphasis with that. And that's a primary thrust. Do people know Jesus Christ? And there's a lot of things going on. I despise, I abhor abortion and the state that we're in. And there's a lot of things in our government, and there's a lot of things in our elections, and there's a lot of things socially going on in our world. But there is nothing more important than the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because I guarantee you that everybody after their death will be pro-life. I guarantee you that. Not everybody in heaven, there will be. We're going to see a great host of souls of those who were aborted. And don't twist that the wrong way. Some people do that. But the gospel mind, do people know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior? Do they know the answer to that question? If you were to die today, do you know for sure you'd go to heaven? And how do you know that? And that's a loaded question. The second chapter is the humble mind. The humble mind. Let this mind be in you. Esteem others higher than yourselves. And then he gets into the person of Jesus Christ. How Jesus Christ left heaven and took upon himself the form of a servant, took himself the form of a man, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. What a wonderful thing to examine and understand and study right before we celebrate and remember the crucifixion, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And now what do we do with that? Okay, we're saved. We've believed on Jesus Christ. We've believed the gospel. What do we do here on out? And that's what he's dealing with now. He's dealing with how do we live? How do we live? Or here, let me give you this question. How can you be a successful, humble servant? See, sometimes we have in our minds that if you're successful, you won't be humble, or if you're humble, you won't be successful. The Bible disagrees with that. You can be both humble and successful at the same time. Matter of fact, I give to you that if you're not humble, you won't be successful. And if you're successful and you're not humble about it, then your success is gone out the window. It's not really God anymore, it's you. Or me. So my question is, can you be a successful, humble servant? I want to give you two illustrations up this morning that I believe you can. Look with me at verses 17 and 18. Paul is talking about himself. Paul is talking about yourself, or I call it here, do it yourself. It's a DIY project. He says, yes, and I am being poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith. I am glad and rejoice with you all. For the same reason, you shall also be glad and rejoice with me. I want you to stop and think about who the Apostle Paul is. If you go back, when we get into chapter 3, we're going to see who the Apostle Paul is. The Apostle Paul was a very educated person. He was a very knowledgeable person. Before he was saved, he was a very respected person. He was part of the Sanhedrin. He was of the tribe of Benjamin. He was a Jew of the Jews. If he was in our day and age, he would have been on the Honor Society. He would have been in the Who's Who. He had an earned doctorate with Gamaliel. Before he was ever saved, he was respected. He said, listen, I want the authority to go persecute Christians. Boy, they gave it to him. If Paul spoke, people listened. And then something happened on the road to Damascus. And that is Jesus Christ spoke to him. Jesus Christ spoke in an audible voice. And a light shone from heaven. And Paul stops because he's blinded. And he says, who are you, Lord? And the voice had said, why are you kicking against the pricks? In other words, Paul, why are you persecuting me? And he says, what do you mean? I'm doing God's work. He thought God was talking to him, which he was. I'm doing God's work. I'm a religious person. I'm a righteous person. I'm a holy person. I'm in leadership. I'm educated. I have... Everybody thinks I'm just wonderful. They're patting me on the back. I'm up and on this pedestal and on that pedestal. And he says, who are you, Lord? And he says, I am Jesus, the one that you are persecuting. And Paul is cut to the heart because all of a sudden he realizes the actions that he has been doing, the persecution, the beatings, and the murders, and everything else, the jailing that he has been carrying out, are actually not for God, but against God. And all of a sudden, in that split moment, his life changes 180 degrees. Heard somebody say a couple of years ago, yeah, I changed 360 degrees. Well, you know what that means. Turn around, you're going the same direction. No, he changed 180 degrees. He was going this way. He was going to destroy the Christians. He was going to beat the Christians. He was going to kill them. I believe he murdered some Christians. He was going to beat them and throw them in jail. Anything he could, disrupt the church of God. Anything he could. And now he was turned. And now he was turning. He was an evangelist. He was a missionary. He was a preacher. He was a teacher. He was a pastor. And he's going the completely opposite direction. You know what happened to him? He basically got thrown out of Israel. He got thrown out of his comfort zone. He got thrown out of where he grew up. He got thrown out of where he was adored. Actually, they wanted to kill him. We see multiple times in the book of Acts where they came after him and tried to kill him. Thessalonica caused a riot. They let him down out of a window in a basket. He is shipwrecked. He is beaten. He is left for dead outside the city multiple times because the people who loved him and adored him and put him up on the pedestal were now trying to slaughter him. So what do you do when you're an apostle Paul and you're thrown out of your own land? And you can't go there. You know where he goes? He doesn't go hide. He doesn't go crawl under the bush. He says here, I like his description, he says, I am poured out as a drink offering. And if you want to study drink offering, I'm not going to go into all the details, but you can go back into the book of Numbers and you can read all about that. Numbers 28 talks about it. There's another passage, and I don't have it written down here. A drink offering was something that they brought. It was a sweet smelling sacrifice. It wasn't a sin offering like the blood of bulls and goats and the lambs offered on the altar. But it was an extra offering brought. It was just an additional offering brought. It was just because you love the Lord, or there may have been something that you missed in your confession, and so you brought it. And you didn't give it to the priest to drink. You poured it out. You poured it out, and you could never get it back. It was just simply you gave something that you gave to God, and it was poured out, and you couldn't save it. You know, when they sacrificed the lamb, there were certain, and the bullocks and all that, there were certain parts that the priest kept out, and that was their food later. You couldn't do that with an offering. It was totally gone. Take a nice glass of iced tea and go out here and find a patch where there's no grass and some dirt, and take it and pour it out onto the dirt, and then say, hey, I want you to drink it now. You won't do it. I won't do it. Because it's poured out. It's gone. And so that's what he says. He says, I am poured out. So the Apostle Paul was comfortable in Israel. He no longer lived in Israel. He lived in heathen territory. He lived with the Gentiles. He was used to speaking Hebrew. He was in a country, now lived in cities, and ministered to people where they spoke Greek and other languages, Aramaic. He was in Rome for a while. You probably heard some Italian. He was in places where he was uncomfortable with the culture. He was uncomfortable with the food. And wherever he went, he got to places, early places, there were synagogues there. And he'd go in the synagogue. But the further he got away from Israel, there were no places of worship that his Jewish heritage had a connection to. Paul said, why are you doing that? Because he's kicked out of Israel? Not really. He's doing it because he was poured out as an offering for God and for the Gentile people so that they would come to Jesus Christ. He says, yes, and if I'm being poured out as a drink offering and a sacrifice and what? Service of your faith. Or in other words, I'm doing this so that I could see you Philippians come to know Jesus Christ. Why did Paul go to jail in Philippi? If you go back to Acts chapter 16, Paul did not have to go to jail. Paul could have immediately claimed his, I almost said Canadian citizenship. That, boy, that came awful close. He could have claimed his Roman citizenship and they couldn't have touched him. But he didn't. He allowed himself to be beaten. He allowed himself to be jailed. And he allowed himself to be in prison. Why? So that people would come to Christ, and the jailer and all his family and the other inmates, many of them were saved that night. And Lydia down by the river had already come to Christ, and the Philippian church was started. Let me just stop here for a moment and let me ask you something. Are you willing to get out of your comfort zone? Are you willing to get out of your comfort zone? You know, we have traditional things at a white English-speaking church that we're used to. And there's a lot of traditions. Let me ask you, are you willing to get out of your teaching or preaching or your hearing comfort zone? Are you willing to get out of your music or your children's ministry or youth ministry comfort zone? Are you willing to get out of your building and setting, physical setting, comfort zones, and say, listen, somebody coming to know Jesus Christ is more important than what I do in this or that? We have to be that way. We have to be that way. In Austin, Minnesota, the world is coming here. You better watch out. I know of two Canadians in town. Maybe there'll be more of us invade this place. I don't know. The culture here is different than Canada. Okay, just talk to the Youpers that are around here. They'll tell you. All right? They're American soil with Canadian accents. That's what they are. There's cultural things. If you look around Austin, we have all different kinds of stores and things now. And the music, I don't know about you. I hope you enjoyed the music last Sunday. If you didn't enjoy the music, then don't even tell me because you'll just break my heart. Okay, but to hear Alberto playing the saxophone and Anna Maria playing the, you know, playing the flute and Linda on the piano and singing, and there's DVDs available of that if you want it, but hearing the worship team sing totally in Spanish. Praise the Lord. You know why? You know why they're singing in Spanish? You know why they're singing their hearts out? Because they know Jesus. They know Jesus Christ as their Savior. Okay? You know why Angel's playing the drums? Because he knows Jesus Christ as Savior. I remember baptizing Angel. So I can say I baptized an angel. You know? But that's neat. And that's just the beginning. And there's so many different things. Am I willing to get out of our comfort zones? Are we willing to be poured out as a sacrifice, giving of ourselves? Let me tell you something for Jim and Sarah. They're not going to Germany to be in their comfort zone. It's not Iowa or Michigan in Berlin. Never been to Berlin. Don't have to go to Berlin. It's not. So humility in sacrifice. Secondly, humility in service. Let's look at the example of Timothy, verse 19. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly, that I may be encouraged when I know of your state. I want to share several things about Timothy. From verse 19, number one, he's willing to go. He's willing to go. Never try to go someplace you're not willing. God will never make you go against your will. He'll just make you willing to go. He will. I was able to share my testimony this week over at Riverland Community College. And I heard a number of different testimonies. And when it was 1970, when it was the middle of 1970, and somebody asked me if I was going to be in the ministry, I was like, no way. Absolutely not. There was no way in 1970 that I was going to be a pastor. There was no way I was going to be in full-time Christian service. There was no way I was going to do something else. But I was not going to do that. That's what my will said. By August of 1972, God changed that will. I'm not in the ministry today. I'm not in the ministry and pastoring, flailing at God and fighting Him tooth and nail all the way. We don't need Christian workers like that. We don't need pastors like that. We need pastors, we need missionaries, we need deacons, we need teachers who are saying, listen, I am so burdened for that person to know Jesus Christ. I am so burdened for those children to be taught the Bible. That I will give up, that I will do whatever. I will do it the complete opposite way. I will do it a different way. Because they need Jesus Christ. Let me tell you something. We're not taking any organs to heaven. We're not taking any keyboards to heaven. What we're taking is souls for Jesus Christ. We're not going to take this hymn book, and this is a good hymn book. We're not even... What Bible version are we going to have in heaven? All right? The New Inspired Version, probably. I don't know. Okay, but all these things, what's our dress going to be like in heaven? What's our language going to be? All these things that we are so focused on in this world aren't going to matter. It's going to be Jesus Christ. Who is He? What has He done? He's died for you. He's died for me. He rose again. He lives on high. And are we willing? And Paul says, Timothy is willing to come. He says, I trust in the Lord to send Timothy to you shortly, that I may be encouraged when I know of your state, of your condition, how you are doing. Secondly, in verse 20, he is willing to follow. I have no one like-minded who will sincerely care for your state. You know, we pastors, we preachers are a real funny bunch. God calls us all from unique and different backgrounds, and we have different personalities. But I am thankful for a number of pastors. Even though we're different and we're unique and we have different personalities, but we are like-minded in the cause for Jesus Christ. I have said it before, I'll say it again. I praise God for bringing Pastor Moises here. He is my Timothy. He is really my Timothy. I can say that I have no one like-minded who will care for their affairs, who will care for their state. And you know why he came to Austin? Just because he wanted to smell pigs every day. No. Just because he wanted more bacon. No, just because he thought, you know, I understand. Do you know that when he moved here, his radiator, his cooling system froze up the first weekend because he didn't have enough antifreeze in? It did. We caught it quick and thawed it out and added a couple gallon and a half of antifreeze. He moved here in January. Why? Because he was concerned for people's souls. He was concerned for some of his brethren who were dying and going to hell from Austin, Minnesota. And let me ask you, what are you concerned about? Are you concerned about, are you willing to follow and say, hey, I'm concerned about my fellow countrymen, my fellow citizens, my neighbors, my work people who don't know Jesus Christ? That needs to be our first and primary concern. And you've got to have a humble mind to do that. If you are self-serving, proud, and arrogant, you will not seek the salvation of others. But he is willing to follow. Look what he says there. I have no one like-minded who will care for your state. Timothy learned from Paul and he followed Paul and he took his teaching. Now, didn't that mean that he became a robot and he became a clone? He was still his own man, but he took and learned from the Apostle Paul. Number three, he is unselfish in verse 21. He is unselfish. He says, for all seek their own, not the things that are Jesus Christ. Oh, isn't that true? Everybody wants, what's in it for me? What have you done for me lately? Grab all the gusto you can get. It's me, myself, and I. Look at the advertisements. It's what you've seen this one on TV. It's my money and I want it now. You've all seen that, right? J.G. Wentworth. All right? That is a downright selfish, self-centered commercial. I'm not saying it shouldn't be, but I'm saying, what is it? It's my money, and I want it now. And have you ever seen that, people leaning out the windows? I've looked around my neighborhood. I haven't seen anybody say, hey, you know, riding their car down the street, it's my money. All right? Why do you have to have that Lexus? Why do you have to have that nicer house? Why do you have, you got to have this awning because so that you can be comfortable. You know what Timothy said? He said, I don't care what's in it for me. He said, I am willing to go. Everybody else seeks their own. And notice it's not Timothy saying, I am so humble. It's Paul saying Timothy is humble. All seek their own, but not Timothy. He seeks the things that are Jesus Christ. Verse 22, he is proven. He is proven. This is vital. I could get off on a rabbit trail here, and I won't do that this morning, I promise, but I just want to alert you, I am thinking of it. He has proven character. He has proven character. What does he say there? But you know of his proven character. That as a son with his father, he has served with me in the gospel. Let me just say this. I'll just point you to the rabbit trail. We should not be sending anybody out, and we should not be calling anybody into a leadership position. That is not proven. That is not proven. That is a real problem nowadays. We've got people that are self-appointing themselves. I feel called. That's nice. You know, I've talked to some people and they've said, well, how do you feel called? Well, I just had this feeling right down here. I said, you sure it's not that pizza you ate last night? You sure it's not indigestion? People think because they have an upset stomach, they're called to something. I'm not saying they're not called. I'm just saying, are you sure? And part of knowing the calling is, do other people see it? Do other people see the qualifications? Do other people see how God has led in your life? You see, it wasn't up to me, although I did feel called. I did believe. It says in 1 Timothy 3:1, he who desires the office of a bishop desires a good thing. But it's not an open door policy that whosoever wants to can walk through it. And he says you need to be tested and you need to be tried. And I know right now there are some men in the ministry, some women in the ministry that shouldn't be there. And he says what? Timothy is proven. You have proven him. You have tested him. You have seen him over a length of time. And he says, you know his proven character. As a son, he has served with me in the gospel. Remember what I told you about Paul a few moments ago? You know what God did to Paul with all of his qualifications, all of his degrees and all of his training and all of his experience? He put him out in the desert for 14 years. He sent him in the desert. He did not turn him around and immediately put him into the Christ gospel ministry. He says, I'm going to put you on the back shelf for 14 years. And he did. And he got Paul retrained to serve Jesus Christ. What did Peter go through? Go through the life of Peter. What did Peter go through before he became an active apostle of Jesus Christ? There's a long history there. He has proved himself to the Philippians. He's proved himself by serving with Paul, and he's proved himself in the gospel. He has served with me in the gospel. And the fifth thing is, he's available. He's available. Therefore, I hope to send him at once. As soon as I see how it goes with me, Paul wanted to go to Philippi. Paul wanted to go visit them, but he was kind of tied up at the time. And he couldn't go. But he says, I hope to send Timothy right now. I hope to send Timothy right away. And Timothy was willing and able and proven and tested and able to follow Paul and says, I will go in your place if you want to send me. Read 1 Corinthians chapter 16 when they're taking an offering for the saints back in Jerusalem at Corinth. Even though Paul's an apostle, he was personally selected by Jesus Christ verbally. He did not say, hey, I'm going to come, I'm going to pick up that offering, and I'm going to take it. He says, you take an offering, you guys appoint two people to take it to Jerusalem. And if you want, if you are willing, if you agree to it, I'll go with them. He could have demanded by his apostleship, by his office of being an apostle, but he didn't do it. He allowed them to make that decision as a congregation and say, listen, this is something that's optional. Do you want to do it? What does he say here to Timothy? He says, Timothy, he's going to go. He says, I'm going to send him as once, and then I want to see how it goes with me. But look at the last verse. But I trust in the Lord that I myself shall also come shortly. I trust in God that I will follow afterwards. I'll follow Timothy. I will come because I want to see. Jump with me back to verse 18. He says, for the same reason you shall be glad and rejoice with me. This is after he talks about being poured out as a drink offering. Are you glad for that person that told you about Jesus Christ? Are you glad for that Adam that shared Jesus Christ with you or invited you to church or invited you to vacation Bible school or youth group? Are you glad for that pastor or that teacher or that youth leader? I don't know her name, but I'm thankful for that VBS teacher. I'm thankful for my father that I heard the gospel from dozens, quadruple dozens of times. But I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for that vacation Bible school teacher that said, you can receive Jesus Christ right where you're sitting. Are you thankful this morning? He says there in back in verse 18. He says, and you are glad and rejoice with me that I am poured out. And now back in verse 24, he says, and I'm going to come see you. Why? When you lead somebody to Jesus Christ, when you have served together, there is an unfathomable bond for eternity. There have been people that I have worked with through the years that I haven't seen in years, dozens of years. There are people that I have been in different places over the years that I haven't seen in a long time. Yeah, it'd be nice if I saw them. It'd be okay. But there are people that I have served with. There are people that I have taught with. There are people that they have taught me. There's a Chris Davis, who was my youth Sunday school teacher. There was a Pastor Benedict who baptized me and discipled me, and they just buried him this week. There's a Pastor Rook that had a great impact on my life in my college years. And he's been with the Lord a number of years now. There's just been a number of folks. And there's a tie there, there's a bind, there's a connection that never goes away. Why? Because they have selflessly, willingly, with proven character, with focus upon Jesus Christ, being available and willing to go, they have poured themselves into not only my life, but the lives of many, many others. There's a dear brother of mine. His name is Bud Hall. Went to school with him. Went to college with him. Sat in many, many classes with Bud. Knew his wife Sandy. Know his wife Sandy. My brother-in-law was her youth pastor. Brother Hall was Jim Ingalls' youth pastor when he was a teenager. Served in one church as a, I was thinking about that yesterday. He served in one church as a youth pastor for 20 years. That's unheard of. That's just unheard of. That's like a congressman saying, I'm quitting after four, you know. It's just never heard of. Yesterday morning, his son went to wake him up, or went in something, and he was dead. He's my age, about 53. Gone. But he has poured himself. And I ask you to pray. You don't know them. There's only a couple of us here that know them. Pray for his wife, Sandy. Pray for his five children, because Dad was gone just like that. Out in Long Island, New York. Just east of New York City. And I can't imagine. I was thinking, I thought, how is that church supposed to function this morning? How's his wife? How's his children supposed to function? His daughter just got married in February. How are they supposed to function today? I don't know. I have no answer for that one. But I know this. I know the Lord saying to Bud, if he hasn't already, well done thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord. What about us when we're done? What about us when we're gone? And dozens and dozens and dozens of people put things up on Facebook. Some, you know, Bud led me to Christ. Bud taught me. He was my youth pastor. A friend of mine, who they were in their church for a couple of years while he was in between churches when we first came out here, he says, my daughter can't stop crying. But you know what? Bud poured himself into people. He served, he was faithful, and he taught. Wherever he was asked, he was willing to go and willing to do. And you know why you don't know his name, except for a few of us that have met him personally? Because he's not on the national screen. He's not on. He doesn't have a TV show. He doesn't have 20,000 people coming to a basketball stadium. But he's probably done more for Jesus Christ than some of those have. Because he's poured himself and people have come to Christ because of him. What about us? Two questions. Number one, are you a servant? Are you willing to serve Jesus Christ? And then number two, are you a humble servant? Are you willing to take yourself out of your comfort zone so that people come to know Jesus Christ? I'm not saying compromise doctrine. I'm not saying compromise the Scriptures. But I'm saying if it's done a little different, or it's done the way you're not used to, or it may not be done as well or as we like it, can we say, hey, listen, we will sacrifice that. We'll willingly give that up for Jesus Christ. I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus? I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me, please. I'm going to go back, leave that up for a moment. And I want you to just ask yourself that question. You can only answer it and say, am I a servant? And number two, am I a humble servant? You can be a humble, successful servant. Timothy was one. Paul was one. Peter was one. There are many examples. I could stand here literally for hours this morning giving you names of humble faithful, effective servants of Jesus Christ. My question is, will you be one of them? And if you have questions, maybe this has raised some things in your heart. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand this morning, as I sometimes do. I just want to ask you, if there's a need in your life, if there's something that's bothering you, if there's something that's pricking at your heart, talk to me afterwards. Set a time to sit down and talk and chat from the Word of God. We'd be glad to do that with you. Let's pray. Father, thank you this morning for your Word. Thank you for the Apostle Paul. Thank you for Timothy. Thank you that what we read here is not manufactured or made up, but it is a truth. It is evidence throughout history. It is evidence by many others that these are real men and women who really served Jesus Christ and poured out their hearts. And we are thankful today for those who have given their lives for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, my prayer is that each and every one of us in this room might not only be servants, but might we be humble servants, willing to be poured out as a drink offering. May we be willing to sacrifice, give up whatever you ask, so that people come to Christ. Father, if there's one here this morning without Christ, may they know Him today. May they stay behind and ask how they can be saved. And Father, we pray that you might take the gospel from here and continue to pour it out around the world, wherever you may send us. And we'll thank you for this in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen.